say is at the last meeting, Councillor Hodson actually made a good suggestion, which was.
It sounds so surprising.
But that we employ two people to maybe on an intensive sort of project to look at this really, and to try and get all this sorted out. But at the time, I mean, the reason we've got the spend freeze in place is because we haven't got any money to employ two people. But I have been having to think about this over the past sort of month or so, and I think probably ready now that is the time that we actually do that. We do get some people employed, maybe on a short-term intensive process, really just a holiday sort of, because everyone's trying to do it in also their day job and everyone's making fires. We are in still a financial situation, so we probably won't be till April till we get those people in. But then hopefully if we get two people in 3 months of April, they can actually help us to work all this year before we all. And then, once all that's through, then in that position, after they've gone and we've got all those purposes ready, we are into performance management now, if they're not able to.
Okay. Well, I always agree Councillor Hodson comes up with many good ideas. How long have we been working on this now?
So I think I commissioned the first review in the summer, I think it was last year. So it's six months, I think it's definitely 6 months, to start unravelling what's happened.
Alright. Well, it's not all right, it's pretty well production, isn't it? And I would be amazed in terms of our level of staffing and the number of people we have if we couldn't have done that a bit quicker. But if it needs new bodies to come in order to get it done, then that's what we're going to have to do. But it seems as though everyone's been kind of complicit in letting this thing go the way it is. So you're right at your first point, which it's cultural, isn't it? Because it comes. Everyone's known about it and they carry on from the top right the way through. So it's not people at the bottom and people down, it's the whole course, and everyone's known about it, just no one's prioritised doing anything about it. Okay, has anyone got any other questions they'd like to ask on this one? No? Alright, let's move on to RIPA.
This report invites the committee to review the policy and on the use by the council of covert surveillance to investigate suspected criminal offences. The existing policy was approved in principle by an inspector from the Investigatory Powers Commission when he inspected the council in December 2018, and the outcome of that inspection was reported to the committee last March. There is, however, a requirement for the council to review annually this policy, and every year we are ready to run a training on the Urgent Investigatory Powers Act. That training took place on the 14th of November last year, and we expect the trainer at the end of that the council to add more detail to this policy by monitoring the social media sites as part of the investigation. A new section 11 has therefore been added to the policy document, which is coming to the report. This section 11 requires departments to restrict monitoring of open source social media sites for officers and be trained in legislation, which imposes constraints on the use of covert surveillance. It has to be in accordance with the Human Rights Act, Data Protection Act, and the Regulation Investigation Powers Act. And the new section 11 will require officers to keep records of their surveillance and the reasons for it. And if there is systematic and regular monitoring of social media sites as part of a targeted investigation, an authorisation will be required from the senior authorising officer and the approval of the magistrate obtained if the purpose is to investigate a suspected criminal offence attracting a penalty of 6 months or imprisonment. So that's essentially what the committee is invited to do, to
Stuart.
Can I just clarify that? This is the relation covers maybe a council officer who wishes to create a profile,
yes,
a social media profile, as opposed to just looking at a Facebook page or social media post?
Well, you can require, you can be authorised to open an official Facebook account in the council's name. You can't use his own Facebook account. And you cannot do anything that is, tends to mislead anyone, otherwise that would be a possible offence under the Confusion Misuse Act. He has to keep records of the surveillance he is carrying out, and if it's regular and systematic, he has to obtain the approval of an authorising officer.
So, Colin, so what? Sorry, I'm getting there. So, what you're referencing is, I thought this was a way of getting behind, you know, something the keyboard warriors that say, do outrageous stuff on the internet, but with false profiles. Finally get behind those, get to the IP, or find out who it is that's saying some of this sort of stuff if they're acting under. But what you're saying now is, I think, is that it's a bit like a fishing expedition. Well, it's not allowed to be a fishing, but you can set something up to, and if people then come and visit that site, you think that they're dodgy, and you can do something about it. Is that right?
Yes, the intention is. Nothing which is against the law. It's essentially, if you're monitoring open source social media, what the law states is that if you do it on a regular and systematic way, as part of a targeted investigation, you need authorisation from an authorising officer and also approval of a magistrate. So you're monitoring social media sites, and that might be part of an investigation trading standards officers into possible
Children's services.
You could be monitoring social media sites to protect children. But what the trainer suggested we do, in accordance with Investigatory Powers recommendations, is that we keep a record of the surveillance that's carried out to ensure there's a proper accountability of what's being done.
So, in a way, what this is doing is bringing anything like that that's been going on into the regulatory framework. So there might be people, I've got a good idea, who wants to buy a load of knocked off facts or something, and that could entrap someone into that. But before they could do it now, they would have to, something would have to be signed by a magistrate and it would be properly done.
Well, yes, and they'd have to go first. First of all, the only people who would be allowed to monitor these sites would be officers who have been trained in legislation, so attending annual training. And secondly, they would need to get in touch with the RIPA coordinator, see an officer in the department, and get his approval to do this. And then, if it was regular and systematic, then a further step would have to be taken. The authorising officer would have to approve it, and we have to go to the magistrate if we're investigating criminal offences.
And of course we get reports, don't we, when you utilise
this power. Yes,
so we will continue to see how many times these powers are
used. The purpose work is essentially to ensure that officers keep records, and they feed in those records to me so I can report to the committee that's going on.
John, you look like you're
No, it's just that you can't use entrapment.
It's just monitoring,
not entrapment.
No,
exactly, it's
monitoring, that's
entrapment.
So, I would never dream of suggesting it, and if I did, I'd wash my mouth out with a cup. Okay. Any more on that one? I can see we're all a bit, so maybe we can, if anyone wants some more information around here. It strikes me that we're trying to put some controls and protect the public from an over-mighty executive or whatever. It's what seems to be what we're trying to do. Yeah, which has to be opportunities. Okay, all right. Are we going to agree those changes? Yep, everyone seems to be saying yes. So that would be yes. Yes, okay. Right. I think, does that take us into the... No, it doesn't. Oh, external audit, sorry. External audit, you've waited all this time for your bit, I do apologise. Okay? Would you like to take us through this, introduce it?
Yes.
Have we met, by the way? Do you want to introduce yourself?
Yes, I will. Firstly, can I give my apologies for Robin Baker, who wasn't able to attend tonight, and the new engagement lead, Mark Heat, unfortunately is sick today. He was going to come along and introduce himself. I'm Naomi Covey, so I'm the audit manager that took over partway through last year and led the team through the financial statements audit to the conclusion. So I've come to present the annual audit letter for the year ending the 31st of March 2019. This is a public summary document. You will have already had the annual the audit findings report, which went into the detail from the audit. This focuses more on the key messages that came out from the audit and draws your attention to what those findings were. Firstly, I'm pleased to say the opinion was signed on the 29th of November, which was an unqualified audit. And the executive summary takes you through some of those key areas. We've already touched on the MRP, so I won't go into any detail on that one. And we did mention there were a number of amendments that had to be agreed from the initial drafts through to the final. I think the officers will appreciate we're under more increased scrutiny, as yourselves are. We have to adhere to much stricter scrutiny from the FRC, so our level of challenge back to the officers is increasing constantly. Hence the view going forward is that we will only sign when we're satisfied that we have got the assurance, hence the delay from the target deadline of the 31st of July. That is something that's going to be probably more prevalent throughout the next few years. Moving on from the financial statements, the value for money arrangements, we're pleased that we gave, from the previous year when there was an inadequate offset rating, we're pleased to comment on the fact that that had now moved to requires improvements, and the reports throughout indicated a steady improvement throughout the year. So that led to an unqualified value for money opinion. We, as already mentioned earlier this evening, we commented on the council's cannot rely on the one-off savings, including the planned use of resources, use of reserves, and latest projections do indicate budget pressures, but the council are working to mitigate those. And we've also completed our certificates as well from hazard benefits and teachers' pensions reserves returns as well. And then I don't really want to go into the detail on the significant object risks. We've already talked about those in detail, but happy to take any questions on those should members have any.
Okay. Anyone got any questions for Naomi? Yes. Away you go, G.
Hi, can I ask you on page 15, please, the last paragraph, you've got in the accounts, we've got family plan expected, and this year's budget for the world growth problem.
Okay.
19 slides.
Page 15, did you say, G?
Yeah, page 15, yeah. That's not coming into the budget this year.
Right.
5 million pounds. Yeah, sorry, there's just one more as well. You've also got the outstanding complaint, that's now the one coming.
Yes, Robin asked me to feedback on that, but he is still looking into it and you should be expecting a response from him shortly. He will continue working with, on that particular objection because it came under his tenure as an engagement lead. We pick up this year's planning, going back to your previous question about the growth company, that's something that we start to look at as part of this year's planning. This was figures taken from 12 months ago.
Thank you.
that's clear in terms of the loan by the loans. What is the position with that in terms of your audit? Are you waiting for information from the authority to be able to respond to complaints, or are you waiting for information from you?
My understanding is that Robin is still reviewing the information that's come in, the response from the objector, and will be providing his report on that.
Okay. Right. That's been dragging on for some time now, isn't it? Yeah. Okay. Can I just be clear?
There's a new complaint, isn't there? Could you give us some background on the new complaint that's coming, besides the one that we've just mentioned?
Can I take that back?
Yeah, certainly, yeah.
Sorry, can I take that back and find out more on that one? Is that
okay?
That's okay.
Yeah, well, thanks. Okay. Do we know what it's about? Do you need to know something about it, or?
It's no, just mentioned about another
complaint. Oh, I see what it means.
Yes, I just
wondered
what
they've got back. So no one told you what it was? No, no. I'm sure you do, John.
No, no, I mean,
but I'd keep it professional. Thank you very much.
I made the objection, so I could answer,
yeah,
but I won't.
Okay. Thank you. You do know. Hallelujah.
There was an objection raised during the draft set of accounts about some omissions. We wrote out to the objector and did not receive a response back, so close that one. If that's the complaint.
I don't know, mentioned the one for 2018-19, isn't it?
I tell you what, sorry. Would it be useful if you could ask someone to brief share on if there's been questions on your accounts? Because these are the council's accounts, not the auditor's accounts. So, what those complaints are and where we're up to. And I would just like, picking up on Ian's point, I'd like some reassurance that any delay, because it has been going on a long time, has not been due to not getting information from the council. It's just how long it's taken to think through it. Yeah. So I'd just like some assurance around that. Okay. All right. Does that pick those two points up? Phil, you had a question.
In the value for money conclusions, reference is made to the course of budget monitoring by Cabinet. Now, I know from the last 2 years,
which is always 2 months out of
it, great difficulty in trying to close the accounts by July or whatever it is. Officers run really hard to try and achieve that because the deadlines get really brought forward. But that's when we're moving into a new exciting system. Committees. Anxious to perhaps will be a bedding in period, but perhaps share with others who may help the orders at the end as to how often a committee, which might be every 6 or 8 weeks, might be able to get information on where things are up to, which will enable committees to fully monitor what's going on. We did talk earlier about all the systems, the processes, the antiquated and old Excel spreadsheets. I've been sure that over the next 2 years, there will be, in 2 years' time, new super duper, whatever. But there will be a desire on behalf of committees to have as much information as possible to know where things are. So perhaps Chair would like to reflect on how that might be achieved, because it might be something the government's working party work on over the next 2 weeks. But it would be helpful for members in general to know how new policy and resources committee, which sometimes say a lot, and the committee chairs will probably be on, will have information that's sufficient to take to help them to make good decisions.
No, well, that's what you,
yeah,
that's what you want, isn't it? I'm sure eventually they'll start getting good information. Now, whether that means we can make the right decisions is another matter. Do you want to answer that, Sharon?
Yeah, I do. Yeah, I mean, with the new system, you know, in theory, the information should be ready at our meetings. If the policy and resources committee meet every 6 weeks, then there shouldn't be an issue with us reporting every 6 weeks. I suppose it would be up to the committee, the chair of the committee, and the committee members to decide what frequency they want the information, and you know, what type of information, how detailed they want to have it, so that it would be able, they can
again, our committee would be wanting that information, so presumably every policy area committee would want that information. And so that will be, it won't be 6 weeks, it could almost be weekly, kind of, you'll have to provide that level of information to the interested citizens.
Yeah, I think, so where I've worked in other divisions before, what the way the system's configured and what the language envisage is happening is, you can get it a touch of button, so we can filter that information or report on it at any level, so that it would be different levels within the organisation. So for example, if children's committee or adults committee, we could press a button and their dashboard would come out with very little, if any at all, human intervention. So that would come out and that could be presented straight to the committee. And the policy resources would have summaries that they would aggregate all those individual reports and have one report for the full council as well. So that, I mean, that's something we'd have to design into the system, but a lot of the systems are we're buying off the shelf of another system, we've got this written already. So this should already be inbuilt into the system. So whichever system provider that provides it, or whether across the government and the public sector. And this is something that's been in place for some time, actually. It's not a new thing.
Look ahead then, let's take Stuart, and Stuart's the chair of the Highways Committee, for example. How quickly would Stuart get the information as chair of the Highways Committee in terms of the spend within that department? Would it be whenever he asked for it? Would it be provided as part of committee papers? How readily available do you envisage that being made? And at what point do you move to that point where that information is available? How long will it take us from now to get to the point where those systems are providing that level of data?
Okay, so once we have a new system implemented, once we have ERP implemented, it's up and running. In theory, Stuart requested that information, we could have it there and then. We've talked before about people having access to the information. There's no reason why Stuart wouldn't be able to go into the system himself and get that information, which should be readily available. What we would probably do is have a frequency of a suite of reports so that everybody's getting the same information for their committees at the same time, so that one committee isn't transferred over from another. So we could do that monthly or six weekly, whenever the committee meets. That would be at the time after the system's been implemented. Between now and then, it's a bit of a bigger ask. So we do know that, say, I'll go back, say, 3 or 6 months. It was taking us sort of a month, 2 months to get this information out of the system, to get it validated by the budget holders and by the directors. Then it comes to SLT. SLT discuss it and challenge each other on whether the information is correct and what they're doing to mitigate any of the actions that we've got in there. Now, we have been developing a system that we've got in-house called Power BI, which is a data warehouse and a dashboard system. So we've been developing that over the past, I would say, 6 months to try and help us get the information out a little bit quicker, with a bit less human intervention, because it's all on spreadsheets. It all comes out of spreadsheets. It all goes into a Word document. Spreadsheets are embedded into Word documents. There's potential for human error if you want to put all this information together. So what we're trying to do, what we have built in, is a direct feed from the Oracle system into Power BI, so the information pops up, if you like, and there is an element of human intervention into this to say, this spend is this much because of this, this is overspent because of this. There still needs a lot of manual narrative and commentary into that. At the moment, we're down to probably about 3 weeks providing that information. So I think we're cutting half compared to where we were 6 months ago, and we are still developing that to make it quicker. The issue we have is, at the moment, doesn't align with the cabinet reporting processes. So,
that won't be around much longer.
Yeah. I mean, at the moment, our 3 weeks at the moment, we might need another week or so, or another, I don't know, 10 days, for it to go through all the quality assurance process. We might have missed a particular cabinet deadline there, so we've got to wait another 2 weeks before that information arrives to cabinet. So it just doesn't all tie up at the moment. But once we go into the committee system, we'll have those deadlines. We'll make sure as far as possible we can get it ready in time for the committee to be able to review it. So we're getting better, but we're not fully there yet.
So instead of one committee, what
needs to be, the questions need to ask how that reporting is going to work, especially if we've got live scrutiny happening within the committee system. You know, I'd like to sort of find out how we are going to address that, and whether that's something that needs to be done here, because there's an element of risk if something's reporting hasn't gone through a check point to say that that can be released. So it's just how that's going to work out. And I don't know whether it's something we should look through you, Chair, to fill. Is that is it, do you feel it's something that needs to be discussed within the governance working group?
I'm happy to sit and talk about that because we've made a lot of progress. I've just been pondering this. Do you mean the other way around? At the moment, so let's suppose somebody dreams up a new calendar for the year. At the same time, Chair and our staff are sort of parallel universe with dates they can pull stuff off and month ends, whatever it might be. As I see the worst case, because of reporting to committee system as print reports and things, they will never match up. But if we were to try and design a calendar which gave Share out of a 6-week head start into the new financial year, whatever it might be, a new committee there, so you try and match up the times that it's needed for the time that you can pull it off by in time to match with committee dates. I haven't thought that one through, but that is what I've just pondered on as to whether it's achievable. So instead of giving you unrealistic dates, we all start out with realistic dates and hold people to them.
Yeah, I think, yeah, there are a number of ways. I think real-time reporting can be really expensive. But in terms, because we're doing a procurement, but I think this goes back to why we want to see the business case. So what is it we're asking for? Because, again, I've done this. People will say it will solve all your problems and it'll be great. And invariably, in Stuart will know this about new IT systems. They're not, because they do start. Which bell and whistle do you want to take off? Yeah. And you mentioned vanilla share, a lot of these. So putting in a vanilla system is relatively inexpensive and straightforward. It's the bells and whistles that start costing a fortune and, you know, start changing your processes. So that's why when we need to see the business case, which is all about, as you mentioned, the statement of requirements. So what are the requirements we're asking for? We don't even know what system we're going to use, do we? Whether it's going to be SAP, Oracle, whether we're going to do it ourselves, whether we're going to have a provider come in to do it, whether we're going to have a shared service centre, or whether we're going to... There's a range of things that need to be done that we haven't been included in that conversation yet. And I think what we've started to do is try and find a way of getting ourselves, inserting ourselves into that conversation about what are our needs for information and awards as well. Is that okay? Great. Everyone had their questions answered sufficiently? Yeah? Okay. Right, in that case, I think we're now at that stage where I need to, or somebody needs to move the exclusion of the press and the public.